Thank you. Thanks. Thanks for coming. Wow, that was a great introduction. Like, I even forgot about what I was doing here. Okay. So, I identify myself as a cyborg because I unite myself with technology. I immerse my body with technology. And I did that because I realized that around us, there are many things that we cannot perceive, like our there's many things going on around our planet and the space that we cannot perceive because our senses are limited. And I realized that if I unite myself with technology, I could reach to those imperceptible things that are going on. But I'll start from the beginning, and all this started because I'm a dancer and a choreographer, and I was studying choreography at college, and I guess when I was creating movement at school, I realized that apart from creating movement, you can also find movement, and there are many things that move around us that we don't perceive. And in 2007, my aim was to find movement in other ways and to get to know movement in a deeper way. And then I used technology in order to do that. And the way that I did it, for the first project I did, it was this type of glove that it will tell me the speed of the people walking in front of me. So this I would have it in my hand, and then I would point at people, and if someone was, and then it would say with numbers, if someone was walking 5 per hour or 7 per hour or 3 per hour with the numbers in my hand. But that had some inconvenience. One was that I had to point at people, and that was quite rude, and it was like a bit intimidating, I guess. And also it tell me the speed of the people walking in front of me, but it said to me the numbers, and actually I didn't want to know the speed. I wanted to feel the speed to make it a natural union. So in order to do that, with a friend of engineers, I transformed this glove into a pair of earrings, and then if someone was walking from right to left, I would feel a vibration on my right ear and then on my left ear, and depending on the interval of each vibration, I would know the speed of the people walking in front of me. And that allowed me, to have this like this new sense and this new perception. And after wearing this for a while, I realized that actually there's this common movement sense that we all have. Like you will probably walk faster or slower depending of the people that you are surrounded with. And I found that very peculiar. That probably you would probably walk faster if you are in London than if you are in Rome, because there's like a movement, there's a common movement sense that we all share. So I decided to start a European project and define each capital city of Europe by the speed of the citizens. Just to remember, actually here the sound is like not that interesting. So I started from Portugal, and then I went around to each capital city, and the aim was to define each city by the speed of the citizens. And I also create like a movement dictionary that define each capital by the movement. So maybe my aim is like to tell to a dancer to move like Paris or to move like Rome, depending of the characteristics of the people that live there. With this research, I found out that in London they walk very fast. Also Stockholm, they walk also very fast. That was surprising. Not Oslo. And Oslo is a very calm thing. And then the slowest capital I've ever been was the Vatican City. Basically, there's just one line of people waiting there. No one ever runs there. If someone is running, probably something very bad is happening. So yeah, after doing this research of the speed I had around me, and then I realized I could feel movement with my eyes closed, and then I decided to turn around my earrings, and this actually allowed me to feel all this open up like my space awareness to 360 degrees. I feel like all our senses are focused in front of our body, but at the back of our bodies we are very dead sensory speaking. We don't sense much. I'm not sure about about how grass is. It feels like very calm and quiet, but in busy cities, I don't know, it happens to you, but I usually like to walk fast. I don't know if it happens that sometimes you find people blocking your way. I get really annoyed by this. So I feel like everyone should have these sensors and feel if someone is approaching you from behind, and then your ways of moving to the cities will change. And actually, it's a sense that we give to cars. Like, cars can sense if they're getting closer to another car, but actually humans, a lot of humans don't feel if they have presence behind them. So actually this new space awareness, I call this retroception, because it was feeling things that I had behind my body. And after experiencing all the movement that I had around, like the speed of the people and the objects and the people I had behind, there was a point that I was like, I was kind of, I don't want to say fed up, but I was kind of, I didn't want my new sense of movement to depend on people or objects. I was like, it has to be something else about the movement. And I thought, okay, if I would be alone in the planet, how could I perceive movement in another way? And then I realized that actually Earth is constantly moving, not only rotates around itself or around the sun, but it shakes constantly through earthquakes. And I thought it would be fascinating to be united to this huge and natural movement, like an earthquake itself. And actually, it's a huge movement, but most of the time imperceptible. So this is when I started what I call the seismic sense. So I had different process. First I had it in my ankle, then my elbows. Then I realized it didn't make sense to have this sense on the elbow, so I put it on my feet. And then for many years I had some implants on my feet that were connected to online seismographs. So whenever there was an earthquake somewhere in the planet, I would feel the vibration inside the body. And depending on the intensity of the earthquake, the vibration I feel, it would be stronger or less strong. And I call this a seismic sense. This new input, it was like, yeah, the sense of feeling the seismic activity of the planet. At the beginning, I had to get used to feeling all these vibrations constantly to have this new input in my body. So, like, yeah, if I was talking, I would get distracted, or I would stop talking, or be like very, so it's like something is happening. Like when I was sleeping, I would wake up more often because Earth kept interrupting my daily life. But after a while, I have to say that I usually sleep very easily. I'm like the kind of person who falls asleep and something and can be a lot of noises, so it worked for me. But after a while, I get used to it, this new input. And a way that I had to describe it is like I felt like I had a new beat inside my body. Apart from the heartbeat, I had the earth beat, having its own rhythm inside my body. So it was, yeah, like having two beats. And I call this cyborg art. For me, the cyborg art is like the art of creating new senses and the art of designing your own perception of reality. The artwork of a cyborg artist would be the creation of a new sense. For me, the seismic sense is my artwork. But and I think also artists nowadays, we no longer need to use technology as a tool. We can use technology as part of our body and change our perception of reality. But there's a problem with cyborg art, or the problem, or like a curiosity, I guess, that the artwork itself happens inside the artist. So in a way, I'm the only audience of my own art. It's like a very individualistic state, no? So I'm like the audience where it happens, like the museum itself, and the artwork happens in the same place. So in order to share what I feel, I create external artwork. And one of the pieces I have, it's a dance performance that it's called Waiting for Earthquakes. And it's like an invitation to the audience just to wait for, just to listen to the earth for a while. And I actually just remember that some months ago I performed here in Graz, in a place I performed this Waiting for Earthquakes. And it works in museums, basically. It's a durational piece, so it can last 10 minutes, or it can last hours. And it's like a bit of like a living a sculpture. I stand still, and whenever there's an earthquake, I move according to the intensity of the earthquake. So if there are no earthquakes, there will be no dance. And lots of festivals are worried about this, but usually Earth keeps moving, so I usually end up moving. And so it's, yeah, it's like a collaboration between the Earth and myself. Earth actually is the choreographer of this piece, and I'm just the interpreter of the data that she gives me. Another way that I have to share this is through percussion, what I call seismic percussion. So in this case, the rhythm and the intensity of how I play the drum is based on the intensity of how the tectonic plates move. I have two ways of doing this. One is also based on real time. So depending on the seismic activity, the piece will be intense or less intense. But I also create scores based on the seismic activity that happened in a specific place. So for example, the first one I did, well, my scores look like this. I'm not a musician, so this is my way of translating the data. So the first one I did was in Mexico, and I researched all the seismic data that happened in Mexico in the last 50 years, and I put it all together in a score that lasted like 10 minutes. And then I went to play it in Mexico, so people from there could hear how their country had been moving seismically through the beats of the drum. So in that case, Earth is the composer of the piece, and I'm just the interpreter or the channel of this data. Also, in 2010, I co-founded the Cyborg Foundation, actually with my childhood friend, Neil Harbison. And we founded basically with three aims. One was to help humans to become cyborgs and to extend their senses. The other one was to promote cyborg art as an artistic movement. And the other one was to defend the cyborg rights, the right of designing yourself and designing your own senses and your own organs. And actually, this word cyborg, It comes from a cybernetic organism. And to be honest, when I was a teenager and everything, it felt like very new for me. I wasn't interested in technology at all. And then suddenly I merged to technology. And then I think journalists were the first ones that called us cyborgs, but first I didn't relate at all. And then we start thinking about this word, and then we realized that, yeah, actually we are cyborgs. And this word was created by Manfred Kleins and Nathan Klein. And actually NASA asked these two scientists to write an article, and they decided this article was about, okay, we have mechanic and we have bionic, and now we need a new word, and they came up with cyborg. And their definition of cyborg was like the people that modify themselves in order to survive in other environments. So if in the human nature it's to keep exploring and going to space, instead of creating a spaceships and staying in the spaceships in order to explore space, we should modify ourselves in order to survive in other environments. And that was like the beginning of this word. So we like to take the beginning of this word, and then use it like design ourselves in order to understand better actually our own planet. And actually, we went to meet Manfred Kleins in California. Because he recently died, but he was like very old, like he was 80-year-old man, and we asked him about what he thought about his word, and he took like 3 days to reply. It's very difficult to synthesize what he said. But I remember that he said that he was very upset with the science fiction industry because they used this word in a very bad way, like using Terminator. So we kind of proclaimed this word back. But since it has been coined, it has been used in many different ways. And then from the Cyborg Foundation, we tried to define cyborg in three different ways. We think that cyborg is an identity, and we thought that maybe as one could be a psychological cyborg, which is the psychological union between cybernetics and an organism. Maybe most of you are already psychological cyborgs. When your mobile phone is running out of battery, you're saying, I'm running out of battery, instead of saying, my mobile phone is running out of battery. So you treat your phone as it was part of you. So you have like this psychological union with the technology. One could be a biological cyborg, which is like the physical union with cybernetics. And one could be a neurological cyborg, which is the modification of the mind and the brain because you've been united with technology for so long. And then something happened to me this summer. I came up with another term without realizing. So I've been having this seismic sense for almost 7 years. And then, this year I started to think that I wanted a change, that I want like something different, like I needed like a shock or something. And then the first step that I did, I was like, okay, I think I need to take these implants out and then be 100% organic again, and then see what happens from there. And then this is what I did, and actually I was very scared. I was more scared to take the implants out than to put them in, because I thought that everything would change or something. And then I took them out, and it was so weird because, yeah, I thought everything would change, and then suddenly nothing changed. And I had this weird effect that I could still feel the vibrations even if I didn't have the implants in. And then this reminded me to the phantom limb effect, you know, like the people that have the arm and then it's cut off and then they feel that they still have the arm. So I had this effect, so I could still feel the vibrations even if I didn't have the implants in. So I thought maybe I'm a phantom cyborg. So I feel like for a while I was a phantom cyborg, and these vibrations kept fading away, and now it's almost imperceptible. So now I'm trying to think of my next step. But yeah, so I was a phantom cyborg for a while. Oh, this is gross. This is when I took them out. I don't know. Yeah, I should take out this photo. I always forget about it, and then I become that breathing. Okay. Also, apart from Venus, like we realize with this merging, like that change our identity. No, apart from redesigning our own senses, we keep finding that it's also our way of defining ourselves that changes. And also, we realize that actually we feel trans-species because we have a new sense, a new organ that is not a human sense or human organ. So we don't feel 100%. And human. And I think this term actually already exists, trans species. And I think it's a bit different from transhuman, because usually the transhuman movement, apart from being very big and sometimes very confusing, the base is, it has this base of improvement or like doing a better human. And we feel a bit away from this term. To be better or worse is actually a very subjective matter. Maybe to feel earthquakes is worse for some people, and for me it was good. So it's a very subjective thing. We don't think that we're doing better things. We think that we have another experience of reality. And so we like to think a more horizontal line, and also horizontal line thinking about other species. So yeah, then species, the definition of this would be someone that doesn't feel 100% human. We don't feel 100% human because we have united to technology, but other people don't feel 100% human for other reasons. So a good example of someone who feels trans-species is my friend Neil, actually, because he has an antenna implanted in his skull. And antennas are not human, they belong to the animal world, but he's very a visual example of this. And he has this antenna implanted in his skull that transforms colors from infrared to ultraviolet into vibrations in his skull. And then this skull, with this vibration, he's able to hear the colors. And yeah, he's the one with co-founded the Cyborg Foundation and everything. So he has this sonochromatic sense, feeling the colors through sound. And actually, when he wanted to have this antenna implant, he went to the hospital to ask the doctors if he could have this implant. And they said, well, you need to talk to the bioethical committee. And then he did. He gave a talk, and then the final decision, they decided that they wouldn't do it, that they wouldn't do this surgery. And then actually the reasons that were given to him, it was like that it wasn't necessary, that it could be dangerous, and they were worried about the image of someone walking as a normal human and then walk out with an antenna on his head. And then actually we find a bit of parallelism with what used to happen in the 20s and the 30s. If someone wanted to have a transgender surgery, someone would feel would have the body of a man, but wanted, he would feel a woman and he wanted to have this surgery. The reasons that they were giving to him is like that it wasn't necessary, that it could be dangerous, and they were worried about the image if someone walk in as a man and come out as a woman. So we kind of find a parallelism with the social reaction of this. So we think that, well, we hope that in the future would be normal to have surgery, to have new organs and new senses. We also founded a species society in Barcelona. And what I like to say about this is that actually we like the I like the logo because it's, well, here it's actually quite united. But the idea is that to have an open circle. Sometimes we think about this image that of humans are very like, we always been the same, like we are like very close, but actually we haven't always been human. No, we used to be a bacteria, then a species on the sea, we went on the trees, we became humans, and now maybe we become something else. So it's a natural evolution for us to keep transforming ourselves. So, and we like this open thing that maybe now we can take part of this transformation and decide ourselves what senses and what organs do we want to have. But maybe, like the union with technology, it's a natural thing that it will happen to our species. Another project that we did in the Cyborg Foundation, actually Neil and I were invited in Brazil for a week to work with 15 engineers that they know a lot how to do things. And we have, okay, we have 1 week to create something. And then actually I have a tooth missing and Neil had 2 tooth missing. So we wanted to create something like to fill up our tooth in a more interesting way. So we decided that, we made like an implant to Neil's mouth and then another implant to my mouth. And whenever I click, he would feel a vibration, and whenever he clicked, I would feel a vibration. And we both know the Morse code, so we were actually able to communicate to each other by clicking our mouth. And we call this the transcendental communication system. So, and we did a first tryout. So I was sitting at the end of a table, and then the audience would write a word. I was sitting at the end of a table, and Neil in the other end of a table, like backwards. And then the audience would write a word, and then it would be like, and then pass it to Neil, and then Neil would write it, and it was like the first tryout of the transcendental communication system. And we call, and it was actually with connection of Bluetooth, so it was a Bluetooth tooth for real. And it kind of like that. Also, this was the first tryout, and maybe it was a bit slow, but actually this could be applied to people that cannot move at all, so they can move their teeth. Also, it can, maybe it's a new system to communicate to space because you don't need air to communicate to each other. So I don't know, the possibilities are open. We have the Cyborg Foundation Labs in Barcelona, and this is Fenix Vinario. He's like the head engineer that he helps other people to create new sensors. And some of the sensors that he has created, it's, for example, yeah, Manel de Aguas, he's an artist from Barcelona also, and he was very interested in water and to feel the weather. So he's creating some fins here in the ears. Fins, I don't know if I say it right. Aletas, you know, fins. Well, never mind. So he can feel the atmospheric pressure with these fins. And if you know the atmospheric pressure, you can know if it's going to rain, if it's going to be sunny. So he's actually the weatherman in person because he can feel the changes of temperature. Another prototype that we're doing is to feel the quality of air. Actually, we'll go to the hand because this is not very useful, but then it's to know if the air is very polluted or not. And maybe this can change your way of going home. Every day you decide the less polluted way to go home. Grass seems okay with the pollution. Maybe Barcelona, it's more helpful, this. And this, I don't know if you remember, but like Neil had another space in, he had another tooth missing. So we put a tooth that created light in, so he had bioluminescence, like some fish have. also we also wanted to work like doing click. So he thought like, yeah, if you are like in the night looking for the keys, then you can do this in your bag and then you can find the keys very easily. But the problem is that when you eat, it goes on and off. So it wasn't that good. So we have to think about another system. But he really likes the idea of having light in his teeth, but it doesn't. It's a prototype. This is Joe Degney, he's another artist that he had the same that I had myself, the light reception, like feeling what's behind. So he made a bit of an upgrade. He could feel what's going behind the vibrations in his cheekbones, actually. And then he could also feel the warmth. So if it was a hot body or a very cold body approaching. So I guess he can know if it's something alive or dead, no? Like if it's just an object or a human being. Pau Prats, all these are prototypes that he did it actually for his college research, and it's a sensor that you can perceive the ultraviolet perception. This is a this is a prototype. I don't know if there are many balls in the room in the house. This is like we have this idea of having this magnetic hair implant that it will react on with the magnetic fields. So actually, if you walk past through a fridge, your hair would move. So it's like it's an interactive hair in the scene. Actually, we went to Colombia and we met the mayor of Medellin. And he's a bit bold, and he was very interested in this implant. So he would be the first cyborg bear with a magnetic hair implant. This is a prototype from a student. Actually, this part of the body, it's called solar plexus. And his idea was to connect to the solar flares of the sun to know because the sun changes the heat depending of the day, so this will connect you to it. And the cosmic sense, this is a sense that from Kyle Landra, is also an artist from Barcelona, and he is feeling the cosmic rays through sound. It's a chip that goes here, but then it transforms it to, he can hear the rays coming from a space. And actually all these senses connect us to connect us to how the planet is. Actually, now that we define ourselves as cyborgs, we don't feel closer to robots or to machines. We actually feel closer to the planet and to Earth. I mean, I felt so much connected to the Earth because I could feel that it kept moving and it was alive. Also, we feel closer to other species because we can relate better how they perceive reality. For example, and sometimes what we think it's very unnatural or very from science fiction, it belongs to nature. I mean, animals can fly, animals can perceive ultraviolet, infrasound, they can create light by themselves, and even immortality already exists in nature because there's a jellyfish that keeps regenerating. So I think we can get very inspired of how they perceive the reality. I think it's very interesting not to think that you can be in the same room, yourself, your dog, and a bee, and the perception that you have from that reality, it's completely different because of the senses and how you perceive the outside world. And we call this actually a revealed reality, RR. We invented that term because if everything was, we got invited sometimes a lot of places about virtual reality. And it's a bit different. We don't think that we do virtual reality or augmented reality. And then we realize that actually what we do is revealed reality because we explore a reality that actually exists, that it's part from our nature, and we create new senses in order to reveal it and to connect to it. Also, we think that for hundreds and hundreds of years, humans have been changing the environment and the planet in order to live more comfortable. But maybe we have arrived in a time that we should actually change ourselves and design ourselves in order to adapt better to the planet we live in, instead of keep changing the planet itself. For example, well, now it's getting dark, but sometimes I give talks and it's bright and daylight outside, and actually we use electricity and artificial light because we don't have night vision like some animals have. So if we all had night vision, instead of creating artificial light, we could like see each other without actually wasting so much energy. Maybe if we could all regulate our own energy, we wouldn't need to cool down the half of the planet when it's very hot or warm it up when it's very cold. We could all adapt it better with our own temperature. So yes, this idea is instead of keep changing the environment, designing ourselves and learn to adapt to it like maybe other species have had. Yeah, and just then, like, I had this project also when I was feeling earthquakes that I wanted to unite the seismic activity of the moon to the moon quakes. I wasn't able to do it in real time, but I did like from some data that I had from the past. And this idea of connecting to space, we call this being a centronaut. We feel that we no longer need to be astronauts and go physically into space in order to explore it. We can remain on Earth and have a new sense to explore space while we are here. It's like the DT version of being an astronaut. So. Yeah, we can all be at home and then have a new sense to explore a space. And just as a conclusion, I like to say to think that we can decide how the union between humans and technology can be, no? And we can decide that this union can get us closer to nature and to animals and maybe to space. Yeah, and thank you. I don't like that picture, so I always change it.